Good afternoon, everyone. Just before starting, I want to apologize for those who wrote me in Element. I'm a bit slow, but I promise you I will really try to answer to the question you asked me via Element. So just be patient, that's it. So I basically wanted to start from where we were yesterday. We were at the scalar property. So we were saying that the standard deviation of so the variability of your capacity of estimating the duration of t, it's basically this the it's k, it's a constant it's the product of a constant and the duration, the base duration, the duration that you are basically discriminating. So this means that basically, the just noticeable difference, and also this minimum difference between two stimuli that enables you to discriminate between them, it's basically varies proportionally. So with the interval that you are at hand, okay. So it means that your temporal system is sensitive to relative differences between the physical duration of two stimuli and not absolute difference, okay? This is particularly, I think, important, and we yesterday we had the chance of saying that this is not a property that is exclusive of the temporal system, but also it's a general feature that the sensory system have, and it's due to a limitation, intrinsic limitations, limitation of the sensory system that become basically sensitive to relative differences between physical properties of the stimuli. And we said that this is pretty common across species because we appreciate that in human subjects and also in monkeys. And this is another example. It's not just common across species, it's also common across tasks. So for example, this is a study. Here, what you see, okay, sorry, it's a study that uses two types of old, is an old psychophysical study by Richard Ivory, who basically tested the invariance of the scalar property of time and different tasks. In one case, the subjects were really discriminating sounds of different durations, so it's a perceptual task. In another case, subjects were asked to reproduce a single interval, as we said yesterday. In this case, they were just pressing, holding, and releasing. So there was first a sound, and then the subject had to reproduce the sound. And here, what you see in plotted in this graph, it's really the on the y-axis the variance, and on the x-axis is the square durations, so the interval that the subject had to reproduce or had to perceive, they had to discriminate, were in these distinct ranges through 300, 400, almost 500, and 550, okay? And so what they really plot is just this variance with the square of the duration, which is what is described by this equation, right? So, and basically they claim that the variance, this is also another assumption they make, is that the variance when you perform a certain task, a center temporal task, some of this variance, some of this variability in your performance is due to really the variability of your clock, of your temporal mechanism, and some other variability can be due to non-specific, so non-temporal feature, non-temporal aspects of the task, you know, that leads to also this variability. So they basically assume that if you regress variance over the square if you do a linear regression between variance and square duration, the slope should be an index of this clock variability, so of a time-dependent source of variability, and the intercept of these curves should basically be indicative of just, should be linked to a non-time, non-specific time component. And basically what this plots is saying that it's no matter whether you're using a perception tasks, which are basically the performance with the black dots, or if you do a production task, basically the slope, those two slopes are very close. So this is taken as really a demonstration that the scalar property holds even across tasks. So when basically the cognitive requirement of the task are slightly different, no? But then I want to show immediately something that is slightly different, so in the same paper. So this is the same plot, but for the production task, rather than the subject, rather than producing single interval, so they hear a sound beep and they have to press and release, they basically have to synchronize their movement of their fingers with an external rhythm. And the rhythm stays there for a while, and after a certain amount of time, it disappears, the external input, and the subject has to keep going with this finger tapping in absence of this external feedback. And as you can see now, the two slopes are quite different, right? So what I mean is in this task, you still need time because you have to really precisely tap, and your tap should have a very high temporal precision. In one case, it's is synchronized to an external trace, or you have to internally generate this structured rhythm. And if the task slightly changes, you lose this scalar property because you see the slopes of the two lines are different. So this is already a demonstration of the fact that the Weber law holds, but not often, so not always. So there are cases where, I'm not saying that the Weber law doesn't hold. I'm saying that it's not always the same across different conditions. So your performance, your temporal performance depends on the task that you are performing and on the requirement, the specific requirement the task has, okay? So somehow the differences across the different duration is still there. No, because your variance increases with the square of the interval. So the disproportionality of your performance is still there, but it's not exactly, it doesn't have the same rate as in the other task.
Sorry, okay? Renika, so does the change in the intercept has anything to do with the fact that you have to do some calculation in the second task?
No, in the second, well, you don't have, so the intercept could be, you know, the change in intercept according to them could be due to the fact that you are doing something slightly different, no? So the it's requirement that the fact that you are moving your finger in different ways, right? Something that doesn't have, it's a motor, but it doesn't have anything to do with time, according to them. But here in the second plot, in the plot that I show later, here you have not just the intercept change, you have a change in slope. So according to the model, exactly.
So there is a window on your screen that maybe you want to remove. So it's a warning.
There is a warning? I don't see this warning in my screen.
Okay, now it has disappeared.
It disappeared because now I'm not in presentation mode. Nevertheless, I have to change what to share. Okay, stop share and I share something different because I change the, I have to change PowerPoint. Okay. Tell me whether or not.
There.
Yeah, okay. Do you see dedicated versus intrinsic, right?
Yes, yes.
Do you see the warning again?
Yes, we see the warning that say there aren't any warning for this presentation.
Ah, there aren't. Okay, because I don't have any warning now. Okay. And I didn't have before. Okay. Okay, so now let's really move into the models, no? And one of the, there are several ways, okay. First of all, I have to warn you somehow that all the models that concerns time are very, often are not very good models according to me because they are often don't make very clear testable predictions about, you know, about this model. So you want really to test them empirically. And some of them are a bit vague, no? You can, you have data and you can fit with this model and that model. So I hope you won't get too disappointed by this models. Anyway, so one way of sort of make big categories out of those different models is to distinguish between models that dedicated versus intrinsic models. So models, this big sort of distinction concerns the fact that some of those models assume that you have mechanisms in the brain that are really specialized, they are dedicated to temporal computations. So there is a modularity in for time in the brain. And to this category belong the internal clock model and multiple oscillators model. On the other category, so the, when we talk about distributed timing models are all models that assume that really this modularity doesn't exist really in the brain. So there is no dedicated mechanism or dedicated brain area that computes time, but time is really intrinsically computed in the brain. And any, at the most extreme version of this, the most extreme version of these models, any brain region can, in principle, it's in principle able to compute time. And the models that belong to these categories are multiple timers, energy readout, and state-dependent network models. So, but I will start with internal clock model. That it's, this is a very old model and it comes from information theory. So it's a model that really doesn't want to have a biological plausibility really. And it doesn't have a biological plausibility. It's a model that assumes that there is a clock in the brain and this clock is a sort of a pacemaker, is an oscillator. And this oscillator oscillates at a certain frequency, at a base frequency. And there is these ticks that are produced by this pacemaker are accumulated, are counted somehow by a structure that it's called an accumulator, that its function is really accumulating these ticks of the clock. And basically this clock stage, this accumulator, it's very important because the clock, it's sort of, it's always right. There is no variability in the clock. The clock ticks always the same frequency. Your perception of time is function of the number of ticks that are accumulated into this accumulator, okay? So the greater the number of ticks in the accumulator, the longer is your perception of time, okay? And this modes, this switch mode, this is a switch that is supposed to be basically a mechanism that gates, so that allows the ticks to be entered into the accumulator, right? And this is this mode, this switch can be modified by the level of attention. So if you pay attention to time the sort of this gate opens, let's say, okay, this switch opens, whereas if you don't, it closes. So what also is, it's, so whatever, so there is this basically clock stage, then there is a memory stage. This model assumes that once this information is stored, it's stored in a working memory, then you have a reference memory. So the current information, let's say the incoming sensor information, is stored in this working memory. Then what you do, you compare this working memory, the information that is stored in the working memory, with the reference memory. And then there is a decision stage where you compare the working versus the reference, you make a decision, so you decide. So as soon as you see this, you immediately get that this model is very tuned to a certain task, which is basically this two interval force choice task, right? It's a task where that it's a model that assumes that you have something incoming, that you have a reference that you somehow stored in the past by experience, by a learning, and then you do this comparison and you make a decision. But for example, it's not a model that can be applied when you do reproduction, for example. This is something that it's already disturbing about this model, that it's super tuned to a specific task and cannot be easily generalizable to other type of tasks. But anyway, so what is important about this model is that the model assumed that any perceived temporal interval, it's the result of this sum of the pacemaker bits into the accumulator. So the model, so the clock is universal. No matter, for example, no matter the length of the interval that you are, that you are perceiving, that you are producing. So no matter whether it's just half, so it's 50 milliseconds, or if 3 seconds. So according to this model, you use exactly this clock. No matter whether what is the sensory modality from which you get the signal, right? So no matter whether you are estimating the duration of a sound or that of a visual image, and no matter also of the task that you are doing. So even though you see it clearly that it's tuned to this task, anyway, the model assumed that even if you have to hit the ball when you play tennis, you use exactly this clock. And also important is that any source of variability shouldn't affect the clock, but the switch and the accumulator. So the clock always, it's always, as I said, correct. It always kicks at the same frequency. So, okay, the universality somehow of the scalar property is always taken as a proof that the internal clock, that the mechanism that tells time is universal, okay? So this is always taken as a, is one of the argument that the supporters of the internal clock model brings. But as I show also now here, this is also a very, very old paper, one of the first psychophysical papers that tries to see whether time perception follows Weber's law or specific or a special case of it. Is this paper of the 1975, where it shows basically that this is the standard deviation in milliseconds, and these are the time that the subject has to discriminate. And basically it shows that the Weber's law, it holds for a range that goes from 200 milliseconds up to more or less 2 seconds, but above 2 seconds doesn't hold anymore. You know, the steepness of this curve rises up immediately. So also another case where the steepness changes. So the Weber law is not so universal. Also another empirical evidence that is a bit of against of this universality of the scalar property comes from this interesting study where basically the subjects were asked to perform several tasks, using also, some of them were more perceptual, some others were more motor. Like, this is a multiple tap interval. So this is similar to what I said before. So subject has to synchronize with an external metronome. So you see here the ticks. So there is a synchronization phase where you synchronize with the metronome, and then there is a continuation where you just keep going without the external metronome. And here you basically, you have, you do this task with different interval, with different base intervals. So you tap where, so the, see here, the duration is not in the tap, I hope you get, but it's in the distance between taps, okay? Sometimes this difference is 300 milliseconds, sometimes it's 450 or 550 or 850, okay? In the single interval tap, you do more or less, so that the motor requirement are similar to that, but rather than having a very continuous stream of movements, here you have single taps. So you have two beeps, beep, beep, and then you have to reproduce by tapping. You have to sort of produce the interval by giving an onset and an offset with your movement. Okay, so these are belongs to motor category of task. This is with multiple intervals, which is a single interval. And this is a more, those tasks are more perceptual. In one case, you listen at a sort of a rhythm. Again, you have a base interval to attend. And then you have a comparison where the intervals is shorter or longer, like in this case, and you have to decide whether this second was longer or shorter than the first, okay? This was longer, this was shorter. So you have always to compare two rhythms, let's say, okay? In here, you have more or less the same perceptual task, but rather than having rather than comparing two things that happen sequentially, here you have to basically categorize. So what you hear is just a single rhythm, and then you have to categorize the rhythm as belonging to the short or to the long category, okay? So there are, so generally speaking, you can, there are two main categories, action, perception, single interval or multiple intervals, okay? And here, what they do, they just plot the variance, so the variability of the performance of the subjects. This is a group of subjects, healthy individuals, and as a function of the square of the interval. And again, they look at the steepness of those curves and the intercept. And as you see, those curves are totally according to the task. This is SST, MMT, CAT. These is basically are the those different multiple tap. This is categorization. This is discrimination. This is single tap interval. So are all those different conditions basically. And the interval were given either in the auditory modality or in the visual modality. So these taps were either beeps or flashes, okay? And you see that basically here, there is a lot of, although there is still disproportionality, so the performance changes as a function of the base interval you are handling, the steepness of these curves is different. So again, this is another example of how it's this universality, it's not so universal in the end. So that if the clock is the same, if the mechanism is the same, you shouldn't see all this variability across the task and across the sensory modalities. Now, I want to move into another proof of the universality of the clock. So another empirical data that seems to... Yes.
I think there are a couple of questions in the chat.
Ah, sorry, I don't see the chat. Ah, yes. Yeah,
so it's my fault. So Marsha Matachari asks whether you could explain again the intersection in the graph on the left. So I think this was a couple of slides ago.
See.
You had this.
Yeah.
Okay, so probably it was even the other presentation, but yes, it should be the intercept in these graphs.
Exactly. Well, the intercept in these graphs should reflect variability that it's not due to the clock. So if you interpret this data as if you have an internal clock, so this variance, so that the intercept should reflect, so this difference in the intercept should just reflect variance that is not due to the clock, but to components of the task, the different motor requirements. Is this that you asked?
Yes, I think this is a question. So,
whereas the slope should reflect variability that is due to the clock, to the motor, to the genuine temporal components of the task.
Okay, so there is another question that maybe has to do with what you mean by model. So the question is, how do you simulate this model?
How do you simulate? So if there are some simulations?
So, does this model correspond to a mathematical model with equations?
Yes, you can find, I can give you the references. Yes, yeah. There are mathematical formalization of these models. I can provide, I didn't really put it here, but there are. I can give you one of these, Treisman. I can put in the, because in the references that I give to my course, there are not those, the references are not so specific, but if you ask for it, I can just add it.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so,
Excuse me, another question I have.
Yeah.
Here in the diagram of auditory and visual diagram, we see different slopes. So can we conclude that our sensation of time through our eyes or through our ears are different?
Yeah. I mean, this is one possibility, right? So this is one possibility. So it might be possible that these differences are due to the fact that you are that the information through which, so the channel through which the information comes in is different to different sensitivity of the system. That's of course a possibility. But another possibility could be that since the channel is different, you use so the channel to which you receive this information does something on the perception, so it's linked somehow to the perception of time. So this model, it's, I found it always a bit bizarre and a bit tautological as well. So it's not very. So, because it assumes as if, so it's assumed the existence of a man with a clock inside the brain, right? But it forgets that you receive information through a system that has certain properties and a sensory system that is, that has to really, his job is to encode, so to extract features from the sensory stimulus. And the any sensory stimulus has a permanence in time, right? Has a temporal dimension. And so this clock really, so this model doesn't take into account the fact that this sensory system passes the information to the clock. And while passing the information to the clock, it needs to do something on this information. And do you see what I mean? So they only assume this high level structure, that which is very abstract, no? And then you cannot even grasp what is this clock. So where is in the brain a clock? No, it's so we have multiple. So the brain, for example, it's they assume that it's an oscillator, right? We have tons of oscillators in the brain. So oscillatory activity. So the neurons sometimes have this synchrony activity, no? And there are different rhythms, no? The different frequency at which they synchronize, but no one has ever shown that there is a particular synchrony that it's linked to time perception. So to go back to your question, it is possible that all these differences are due to the channel, but the question is, does the channel transfer this information in a very neutral way, or does it do something on the signal itself when the signal comes? I don't know if I was clear.
Yes, thank you. It was very good.
Professor, to follow up on that question, so from this experiment, it seems that perception of time becomes nuanced based on instrumentation. And in this case, whether the ears or the eyes. Now, it is evident that the perception of auditory and visual are somehow different.
Yeah.
What happens then when you, how is that reconciled? For example, what if the stimulus is audiovisual?
Yeah, exactly. But that's why we need, this is an important point indeed, because we are able to, we have first of all a unitary percept of things. And also you are able to tell time in different sensory modalities, no? So it means that if I have an audiovisual stimulus and I'm still able to be accurate in time in those stimuli, it means that there is also some structure downstream that has to deal with time, okay? But so what I'm saying is not that everything is just upstream, sorry. So I'm not saying that everything is just due to the sensory system and it's characterized by the channel to which you experience information. I'm saying that the two things are equally valid, that you still have a high level structure that integrates time and serves the integration of temporal information. But you cannot deny the fact that a sensory channel does something on the temporal does a job in extracting this temporal information. And that's my criticism to the internal clock, apart from the fact of it being so vague in terms of where is it in the brain. But as I said, it comes from information theory. That doesn't have it wasn't made with the purpose of being biologically plausible. Okay, but still, I think we have to go beyond this idea of a single mechanism. We really, I think, need to think in a more complex. So things are more complex than this model would assume.
Yep, exactly. Thank you very much.
So, and one, to go back to this question and to move forward to the lecture. So another proof that there are high level areas that deal with time. Is the fact that, for example, if I ask subjects, so far I just told you about psychophysics, no? So only measuring behavior and recording accuracy, J&D, slope, and variance, okay? But if I record a brain signal while the subject is performing all these different tasks, okay? So I'm asking someone to judge the duration of a sound or other the duration of a visual image. And in some people do finger tapping, other do reproduction, other do just discrimination. If you look at this, if I record, for example, if I use fMRI and I record in humans activation, I see which brain areas are active while the subject is engaging in one of those tasks, I see common areas across these tasks and these sensory modalities. Okay, so I see that there are common regions, and we will see which region are those. I'll just first move forward and then go backwards. And this is an example of an experiment of that sort, okay? No, probably I am, sorry, just that the question you made me think that maybe I can just move into this one. Okay, this is related to what I just said. So this is a meta-analysis, okay, of fMRI data. Now, then we go slightly backwards when I have to explain to you what we measure with MRI and how with the logic also in doing an MRI experiment. So, but this is what I just said. So these are areas, you would be color code. This is as a template, is a brain, okay? These are different, is like a different section, so different slices of the brain. So as you cut it in the axial plane. So from top, this is top of the head, this is bottom, okay? This is cerebellum. So if you move, so here from top to bottom, you see that there are areas that seem to be active when you do a motor task, perceptual task, and this is a conjunction. So this is the conjunction of the tasks. So these are areas that are common across tasks. So you see that there is a great level of overlap between those regions in this meta-analysis. And this is basically, I think this refers to sub-second timing, okay? And these are data that refers to supra-second timing. So this is what I just said. So they just do a meta, they collect a lot of fMRI studies and they try to see the common areas, the commonalities, the differences for people that use different tasks and different durations ranges. So I think that here you can be happy and say, okay, there are lots of commonalities. So these areas are, some of them are premotor area. So this is a premotor cortex, is an area that we will see later on is very important for time. And it's an area that, see? Yeah.
Yeah. What is Z is equal to 50 or 40? What is this Z value denotes? That in the diagram itself, there is Z is equal to 50 and Z is equal to 40. So what is this Z?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
In the diagram itself, it is showing that Z is equal to 50. So this is a slice number or something.
Yes, the numbers. Yes, sure. No, the numbers is the basically you have is a 3D volume, right? The brain. So you have coordinates. So in the X, Z, and Y plane. So this is the coordinates in the Z plane. You are 50 in the axial plane. As you again, if you see myself in the window, you just go from up, from bottom to top. So the Z, in the Z, you are at this coordinate at 50, okay? It's in, yeah, it's coordinates in the Cartesian plane, basically, X, Y, Z. Okay, this is the reference space that we use. This is a common brain, okay? So basically you take activations from lots of people and then you put in a common space. It's a template brain. It's not a brain of specific subjects and all. So you see the lower you go, the more negative become the Z. So you have commonalities. You have lots of, okay, premotor areas. So what is also interesting to notice is that most of these regions are regions that are involved with motor tasks. So I was talking about this premotor area. This is an area that normally is active when you plan to make a movement. Before you're moving your finger, this area becomes active, just slightly before you really execute the movement. So it's an area that is supposed to be important when you plan motor movements. But it's also, okay, so you see that it's also involved in time. And all this is also an area that is important for motion, but it's when you it's move when you move you you make an eye movements. So also premotor. Other area that is are seem to be involved in motor is all other areas that seem to be involved in time. It's this the ones that belong to motor circuit, so to the basal ganglia. So these are subcortical areas. So these are deep in the. So this is cortex. Okay, this is deep. It's not anymore cortex. It's just deep in the brain. And also this is it's called putamen. So it's a series of nuclei that are involved that are connected to the frontal cortex, and they're also important for motion execution, movement execution. Cerebellum as well. Cerebellum is very important for motor coordination. So it also has activity that is correlated with temporal tasks. Below seconds. Above seconds, these activity are always are similar. But for example, you see also activity in higher brain areas like prefrontal regions. So these are regions that are important for high cognitive functions like planning strategies, right? An area that are sort of supervised areas of something that happens in lower regions. But more or less, you see a lot of commonalities. And the two areas that seem to be constantly there, no matter the task, no matter the range, are exactly this supplementary motor area and this inferior frontal gyrus. So these seem to be very highly common. Now, what does it mean, all this? So this, in the first place, these are correlational methods, okay? So what you measure with fMRI, and that was this information I wanted to provide. What you measure the level of blood oxygenation. So it's an indirect measure of brain activity, really, no? And you measure, so basically, how much oxygen a given area needs, okay? And because this oxygen supply, it's correlated with neural activity, because the more active the more spikes are in a certain area, the more oxygen you need, the more, there is a metabolic need when a certain region is active, okay? So what you do in MRI, and that's why I just now go a little bit backwards, just because it's important for you to have also, I'm going the opposite way, okay? Just for you to have an idea of the tools that we have at hand and the precision of these tools also. So you see, this is really, you measure this hemodynamic response. So you measure the level of oxygenation in blood. And here, for example, is a schematic difference between an area that is active. So it needs a lot of, so the red, spots are hemoglobin, so it's basically where it's it transports hemoglobin oxygen. So the more active, the more oxygen you need. The you have also an increase in blood flow. You have an increase in the blood flow. So here you see the difference between a rest condition, so where you don't have any, so cognitively then you have nothing to do, and here you are active. It's an hemodynamic response function. So it's an indirect measure of neural activity. And here there are some studies, for example, in monkeys. Nicolo Botidis is one of the researchers that first tried to see what to explore with electrophysiology and with fMRI. Really, he was trying to understand what you really measure with fMRI. So what are, so the hemodynamic response function correlates with what? With local field potential, with reflex, so postsynaptic potential, reflex action potentials. So, and here, really, so it shows that what you measure, so that the changes in hemodynamic response function correlates best with the local field potential. So it reflects more postsynaptic activity. So you don't really, you are not measuring action potentials. You are measuring the consequence of action potentials, okay? So postsynaptic activity. And most importantly here, so what your spatial resolution is a voxel. So it's a 3D pixel, okay? So these are what you get are matrices of numbers that reflects the variations of the signal in the brain. And the spatial resolution of your images is it could vary. Of course, it depends on also on the field, on the type of sequence you are using, MRI sequence. So it depends on the tool. But for example, in a voxel that is 55 millimeter squares, basically, the number of neurons are millions of neurons. So underneath this voxel. So what you are measuring here, it's an hemodynamic response that correlates with postsynaptic activity. So that is a consequence of neural activity. And it reflects the activity of a population. Okay, so it's population of neurons. So the precision is,
Local field potential is a single neural activity, right? No.
No, local field potential, it's reflects postsynaptic activity of populations of neurons, okay?
Okay, either EPSP or
the IPSP. Consequence, MUA, so the multi-unit activities, action potentials. Postsynaptic is what you record in the cell that receives the action potential.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, that's the postsynaptic activity. It's the cell that receives the input, the action potential. It's the, yeah. And so it means that your spatial resolution is really, so what you record is really the population. So, and also what you have to bear in mind that these are what you record when you see fMRI data, you record stuff that are, you're recording activity of a population, and this is activity that correlates with a given task, okay? So it means that it's not, you cannot make inferences about causality, right? It doesn't mean that you need those neurons or those populations activity for the task. It means that when you have a certain task, you observe that kind of activity. But most importantly, I think this is important for you to understand that we don't do, there is a level of precision also in our investigation, in the sense that I think as you grasp the task that we give to the subjects have different requirements, right? In one case, you ask you ask to tap. In another case, you ask to discriminate. So from the cognitive point of view, there are tons of different variables that can explain the different results, okay? So imagine that you want to compare, okay? That you want to compare the activity associated with the finger tapping with the activity that is associated with the discrimination task. If I put a subject in the scanner and I measure differences of that sort, I would be a very bad scientist, because any differences between those two tasks can be due to the tons of differences that you are, that the subject, the tons of differences in the two tasks, right? The tasks are totally different. So normally the way we do things is that if I want to measure, if I want to understand what is the correlates of a temporal task, I really want to be precise and ask a subject to perform a certain task, like to discriminate duration. And I measure activity while the subject is measuring duration. Then I want to ask my subjects to perform another task where he's doing, from the cognitive point of view, he's doing something very similar. But rather than measuring duration, he's measuring some other feature of the task. So I want to compare activations of two tasks that are very similar from lots of components of the task, except the component I'm interested in, which is time. And this is a beautiful example of what I mean. It's an old paper, 2004, and I'll show you what this person did. So he asked, you see, he asked, this is a, so your subject were asked either to measure the duration of those blobs. So for how long the blob was on the screen for, or whether it was, so whether the two, so you have to still compare two things here, right? But in one case, you have to decide which one was longer. In the other case, you decide which one was more purple. So you vary the color, the hue of the stimuli. Okay, so you still have to compare. So as you can, as you can surely appreciate, the cognitive requirement of the two tasks are very similar. What it changes is just the feature of the stimulus that you have to attend, the color versus time. And what also they manipulate the level of attention. So they give, okay, this is a schematic view of what they ask. So there is a cue at the beginning, which tells you which feature to attend, either time or color, okay? So, and here also, this is a graded cue. It means that you have to pay more attention to time and less to color. Here, you know, 100% time, zero color, and so on and so forth. So you have a graded manipulation of attention to those different features. And you go from one extreme to another extreme, okay? And so you measure brain activity while the subject is doing this. And so why it's nice, because then what you do, you subtract. So you subtract activation. You see, if I am paying attention exclusively to color, but not to time, what is left in my brain activity? And it's the same you can do with color. So when you attend to color, but not to time, what's left in my brain activity? In this case, you are sure that what's left refers to the only difference between the tasks, which is either color or time. And what she sees is that, you see, this is our reaction times. So you see that the reaction times over the attentional condition in the x-axis, no? Total time, total color. And these are the intermediate conditions. So you see that there is a modulation in the reaction times, so that the more attention, the more attention, the more you should be, the less error you exactly, the less error you perform and the faster you are. Okay. And the activity, and so then what they measure is that they see, so this, what I'm showing here are all the areas, and these are the, so then these numbers are the coordinate system, the X, Y, Z coordinates of, in this template, of all the different areas that they see. So basically this is the area active while the subject is performing time, but not color. So you see, it's a wide network that goes from areas in the mid-temporal region, superior temporal, parietal, the frontal operculum, the so you go from back to from temporal and back of the brain to the front of the brain, okay? And here instead you see activity in an area, in areas that were that are active when you do color but not time. So in here you see this occipital area. And what is this V4 activity? This is called V4, it's an area that's called V4. And what is nice is that you see how also the activity in this area is modulated by attention. So the more attention you pay, the greater is the activity in this region, okay? And and it's the same, sorry, basically, it's the same for time. So in the activity of the supplementary motor area, so this area here, which I show you before as one of the areas that most consistently is there when you do this meta-analysis about temporal task, also this activity is modulated with attention. Okay, so, but this is beautiful, it's nice. You are sort of confident from the methodological point of view that you are really pinpointing an areas that are there because of your manipulation and not because of something unspecific that it's linked to the differences in the task. But I think there is the risk of missing something, and the missing something is this contribution of sensory regions, right? Because you are extracting information from a visual stimulus and you are contrasting activity, so you are subtracting activity. So in the two tasks that you are, the two tasks that this experiment uses are visual. So you are missing all the contribution of the visual cortices. But for that, you can run more tuned experiment. But just because I'm almost out of the time, the key message, sorry, in this is that sure, you have areas, high level areas that are seem to be engaged with temporal computation. So there must be something high level. There must be an high level clock, but it's not always, it's not only and exclusively this internal clock. And we'll see later, next week.
A couple of questions already, yeah. In the chat. I don't know if you want to finish then.
Yeah, no, I'm done. So I think I will end, finish.
So one question, Inba, okay, goes back to the two different models. So, no, sorry. Inba, okay, what happens when a person is performing several activities at the same time? So being multitasking, which areas are activated? I think you addressed this to some extent. Maybe you want to say something more?
No, when you do multitasking, if you do multitasking, I would expect that common areas are, so the areas that are active, so I would see the same network if, so depends on what is common and what is different across the task you are performing, right? So if there are similarities in the attention load that is the task requires or the motor component that the task requires, I expect to see similar activity, okay? But a question, another question is what happens to the perception of time when you do multiple things? And this has been, so when you do multiple things, so if you are engaged in multiple activity, your perception of time, it's worse and you have biases. You tend to perceive time shorter than it actually is. And this has been done in a proper experiment.
There's another question on going back to the distinction between the two models. I think you discussed only this dedicated model, no? But this asks, do these experiments shed any light on the discussion between this dedicated versus intrinsic models?
Yeah, well, observation, so all the observation that pinpoint to areas that are common across tasks, across sensory modalities, that highlights these commonalities, they seem to sort of suggest that, especially, okay, maybe the last example, the last experiment I show, I can answer by referring to this experiment. So if I subtract time versus color, and I see that only in the time task, I see activity in supplementary motor area, I can say that maybe there is a sort of specialization of this area for time, because this area, it's not active for color. So somehow it looks like that the supplementary motor area has a specific function for the temporal task that doesn't have for the color task. So to some extent, it is modular. It has a specialization. I think here the question is not being modular or not. It's not 0-1. It's not binary. I think it's the degree of modularity that it's questionable. That it might be not so absolute. So you might be, there is an area that it's specialized to time and other things, but not 100% to time.
Okay. Other questions?
So next, okay, no.
Go ahead.
Next week, I will present some data that tells about, so that emphasize more the role of sensory regions, okay? So we go into the other extreme in seeing what's going on with these sensory regions.
Yeah. Okay, so then I think this is a good time to stop. Thank you again, Domenica.
Thanks, Matteo. Thanks to all you guys. And be patient, I will reply to your chat in Element. And I will post these extra references, actually, to the Treisman model, for example, for more mathematical formalization of it.
Okay, so with this, we wish you all a very nice weekend and see you on Monday.
Ciao, have a nice weekend.